Welcome everybody. At the CensorLab Forum today, we have the pleasure of hosting Margaret Wertheim. Margaret is an internationally noted science writer, artist, and curator, and her work focuses on relations between science and the wider cultural landscape. She's the author of 6 books, including The Pearly Gates of Cyberspace, A History of Space from Dante to the Internet, which I have in my bookshelf, but I'm going to get a personal signing after this. And her crochet coral reef project is now the world's largest participatory art and science endeavor. Today, Margaret's presentation will explore the lineage of visual verisimilitude from Giotto to Grand Theft Auto, and trace the roots of virtual reality, which often is considered a technology of the computer era, right back to the Middle Ages. Thank you.
Well, thanks for having me. It's lovely to be here. It's delightful to be at a place called CensiLab. We live in a digital age, and it's lovely that there is a place that is focusing on senses. So I thought before I begin my talk proper that I'd just give you a very brief introduction to one of the things, the background of what I do these days. I'm sorry, we have a technical thing. This is not advancing. So basically, by profession, I'm a science writer and science communicator. I actually began my career doing physics and maths at university for 6 years and thought I'd become a theoretical physicist, and ultimately decided to become a science writer and science communicator instead. And what's really animated my career is a desire, really, to understand science and mathematics within a wider cultural context. So I'm interested in the way in which science and mathematics affect culture and the way in which cultural ideas affect science and math. And what I'm going to be talking about today is the cultural history, effectively, of virtual reality. But this fits into a project that I've been doing more recently, which kind of relates to what you're doing here at CensiLab, which is about 10 years ago, out of my frustration with feeling that there needed to be more creative and imaginative ways to engage with science and mathematics. In Los Angeles, where I live, I founded an organization with my twin sister. It's called the Institute for Figuring. And the IFF is an organization formally devoted to the aesthetic and poetic dimensions of science and mathematics. And what we do is we're basically interested in taking ideas from physics and maths and other kinds of sciences like computation, and showing people how they can, as it were, engage with these ideas through material physical play practices. So we do things like build giant models of fractals out of business cards, we crochet hyperbolic representations of coral reefs, and basically it's an idea, effectively, if you think about, there are things that we have in our society called think tanks, where people go to think about big ideas and they write position papers and books, etc., and opinion pieces. Well, Christine and I believe that society needs places where we can play with ideas, and that's what we do with the IFF. So in a way, we're a CensiLab too. And one of the things that's animated our work with the IFF over the last 10 years is a huge amount of projects that we've done, which are all in one way or another about concepts of space, like hyperbolic space or fractal geometry. The idea of space has been central to a great deal of what I've been doing for a very, very long time in my career. And the book that I'm going to be talking about today, or talk that I'm going to be giving today, is based on a book that I wrote called The Pearly Gates of Cyberspace, A History of Space from Dante to the Internet. The book actually came out 20 years ago. I just realized the other day when I was preparing this talk, it was literally 20 years ago, I think in July, that the book came out. And what it is, it's a cultural history of concepts of space from the Middle Ages to today. And I was interested in tracing how did the scientific conception of space, you know, with Galileo and Newton and ultimately on to people like Einstein and multi-dimensional spaces with string theory, etc., How did these ideas come into being in our culture? How do you, as it were, reconceive space within a cultural framework? And in the course of researching this book, I uncovered a really wonderful story, which is effectively about the relationship between the coming into being of the scientific or physicist conception of space with artistic conceptions of space. And that's the story in part that I'm going to tell today, the history, as it were, of Western thinking about visual verisimilitude, which is now, you know, what we think of as being virtual reality. To understand why this concept is so revolutionary and why I think in many ways it remains revolutionary, I think it's valuable to have a conception of what it is that came before it and what was, as it were, the profoundly different way of thinking that this new conception of imagery entrained. So let us begin in the Middle Ages, before a conception of geometric construction of space existed. So in the Middle Ages, as I'm sure many of you know, people had a very radically different conception of the cosmological scheme in which they were embedded. As it were, cosmological space had a different framework. And it looks like this. Basically, for people of the Middle Ages, as it had been really since the time of the ancient Greeks, Europeans believed that the Earth was at the center of an angel-filled cosmos with everything connected to God, that the center of the cosmic system was the Earth, and around it were, as it were, the crystalline spheres that carried the sun, the moon, the planets, and the stars around us. And one thing, for the purposes of my talk, the critical thing about this medieval cosmos was that it was finite. Space wasn't conceived as something that went on forever. It was a small bubble, as it were, that ended at the outermost sphere, which was called the Primum Mobile. That was the sphere that God moved. God created that motion, which was then transmitted to the planets below. And outside the Primum Mobile, sort of metaphorically outside, it was conceived that there was, as it were, plenty of room left for God to be, and that was where the spiritual space of heaven was located. So the physical universe was seen as really a small and very minor part of the total cosmic scheme. And the total cosmic scheme for medieval people involved the physical universe, which is the sun, the moon, the planets and stars, etc., and then the spiritual scheme, the space, as it were, outside of the physical world. And this spiritual space had its own geography, which is beautifully mapped for us in the Divine Comedy of Dante. And for those of you who haven't read the Divine Comedy, basically, there are three, as it were, primary regions of spiritual space. There's hell, which was conceived of in Dante's Comedy as inside the earth. Then there's purgatory, which is a mountain on top of the earth, facing upward towards God. And then there's beyond the physical world, there's a spiritual realm of heaven or paradise. And the Divine Comedy basically takes Dante on a journey through, as it were, the physical hell of down inside the earth, up through the mountain of salvation, which is purgatory, and up to the realm of salvation, which is heaven. And for many evil people, this spiritual realm was the primary realm of the real. And the physical world, the physical space of the cosmos, the earth, the stars, and the planets, was conceived as really, as it were, the secondary space of reality. True reality was the eternal spiritual realm of the Christian soul. And this is what medieval imagery seek to represent. Medieval painters weren't interested in painting the physical world around them. They were interested in iconically representing the realm of the soul. And here we have, from the early 14th century, Giotto's version of redemption. Basically, this is a representation of the afterlife. And so what we have here on the left-hand side is a representation of those who are saved, who are destined to go to heaven up above, which is this angel-filled space at the top of the image. And on the right-hand side of the image, we have those who are in hell, who are not destined to be saved, who are going to spend their life in hell. And they're down there with Satan in the right-hand side of the image. And in the middle of the image, rightly, in the centre of the spiritual universe, is Christ. And what's one of the things that's important to note about this image is that Christ is by far the biggest figure in the image, and then the saints and the martyrs and the angels on either side of him are still very big but smaller than Christ. On the left-hand side of the image, the people who are going to be saved, who are going to heaven, are smaller than the angels and Christ but still relatively large. And on the right-hand side, the people in hell are miniature and tiny. And that's because what's going to happen here is that this is iconic representation of the spiritual stature of beings. So Christ is by far the biggest figure because he is the one who has the greatest spiritual stature and weight. Angels and martyrs come next, then people who are saved, and then the tiniest figures of all are the ones in hell who are literally spiritually puny, and therefore should be represented in a spiritual scheme as it were minuscule and irrelevant. So this isn't, these people are painting like this because they want to represent a cosmic order of the soul. But at the same time that Giotto was painting this image in the early 14th century, all around, this is an image from the what's called the Arena Chapel or the Scriveni Chapel. But the rest of the chapel is filled with images depicting the life cycle of Christ. And these are depicted in a radically new way, which I think we can think of as a kind of medieval virtual reality. So in a series of three bands of images that all depict different scenes from the life of Christ, what Giotto paints is a radically new way of seeing the world. So what we're seeing here is not an attempt to portray the spiritual order, but an attempt to portray the physical world. So here we have an image from the life cycle of Christ, with Christ and in a mountain scene with animals. And we see this is an attempt to portray what the landscape really looks like. And this is the time when, in Western culture, science is coming back into fashion. European people are rediscovering the ancient texts of the Greeks, and they're beginning to think once more about the way the physical world is constructed around them. And what they're beginning to do is to have an imagination of how painters could start to represent the physical world in a realistic or naturalistic sense. And so we see here not just attempts to represent mountains and trees, but animals and humans in the same scale. And here's a really great representation from this same, all these images are from Giotto's Arena Chapel. Here we have the baby Christ and the mother Mary with an angel at the top in the right-hand side and followers around. And we see that all of the figures are represented at the same scale. Mary, Christ, the angels are the same scale as the people. So what we're seeing is a radical reconceiving of how artists present imagery. Here's another scene from the Arena Chapel, and what we see is buildings. These buildings, they don't look completely realistic, but we do understand this as an attempt to represent paintings in a coherent physical space in relation to one another, as they are in the world around us here on Earth. And this new style of representation is formed by a radical theory on the idea. The radical idea is that God has created the universe according to the laws of geometry. So if that's how God has created the world, then that's how artists ought to portray it. So Giotto and his peers were informed by, as it were, a theology that they wanted to create a kind of realistic imagery that would not only show the world as God had made it according to Euclid's laws in theory,
but it would have a kind of psychic power that by representing the world in this new realistic way, that what they hoped to achieve was to actually make people who were standing in front of these images believe that they were actually seeing the life of Christ represented in front of them. And so this is very much a concept of medieval virtual reality, although people didn't use that term then. A term that was used at the time was geometric figuring, and that was a term that was coined by a Franciscan monk, Roger Bacon, who was very early proto-champion of mathematics and science. And he put forward in a document in the year 1267 to the Pope at the time, he put forward the idea that since God had created the world according to geometric laws, that if artists painted religious scenes in that way, they would make people truly believe in the scenes that they were witnessing, particularly the life of Christ. And that could bring about a reinvigoration of Christianity and inspire a new crusade. And it would also have the power, Bacon argued, to make unbelievers believe in God themselves, because what they would be so overwhelmed by the, as it were, the reality of what they were seeing, that they would be inspired in religious fervor to think, I really am, as in here, looking at this scene of the Annunciation with the Archangel Gabriel coming to visit Mary. And so one of the things that's radical about this diptych here from the Arena Chapel is that not only do we see, as it were, a realistic mode of representation of the people, but this fantastic thing of the architecture that's painted around them, these little balconies appear, they're an attempt to create an illusion that the balconies are jutting out into the real space of the church itself. So this is one of the first attempts in history to, as it were, connect the physical space of the actual viewer with the depictional space of the image. And this is to blend, to give you a sense of blending of the physical space you're in with the space behind the picture plane, to make you feel that you are really there in front of these real scenes. So I think it can legitimately be called a medieval form of virtual reality. Psychologically, what they were doing was wanting to get, what these painters were doing is wanting to give the viewer exactly the feeling that we have now when we do the VR set with the goggles or watch 3D computer game. We want to feel like we're there embedded in the action. And as I said, there was a psychic purpose to this. It wasn't just a form of visual trickery, and it was a form of visual trickery, but it was propelled by a psychological desire to make people believe in what they were seeing, to reinvigorate Christianity. Now, it didn't actually inspire another crusade, but what it did do was kickstart an absolute revolution in visual imagery that over the next century or two would be codified with the laws of perspective carried out through geometric means. And by the time we get to the late 15th century, the perspective revolution has been, as it were, completed, and we have these images from Raphael. This is from Raphael's series of works in the Vatican. And what Raphael is depicting here is, this is in fact Euclid drawing images of geometric figures on a tablet, because these are the laws not only of the world, but now of visual representation. And this is a detail from a wider scene. And what this scene is representing is a whole lot of great thinkers throughout history, including Euclid. But what's important for the point of this talk is that this scene now, painted in the 16th century, we recognize this now as a coherent, geometrically unified pictorial space. So everything is, as it were, in the same technically coherent space. with the projective point, sort of the vanishing point at the sort of in underneath those arches there. And we recognize this, that everything is in the right geometric relationship to one another, and it's one single geometrically whole environment. And we see this is another lovely Raphael image that gives you the same, as it were, feeling. Again, everything is unified in a coherent, geometrically unified space. Now, underneath these imagery, the perspectival painters were indeed doing what exactly a lot of you guys who are doing virtual reality representations today are doing. This is an image from Paolo Uccello in the mid-15th century, and it's, as it were, this is like Renaissance wireframing. This is done in something like 1430, and it's a famous image in the history of perspective representation, because technically what he's doing here is actually representing this chalice as a wireframe drawing, and we know that it's correct to 17, from 17 different perspectival, from 17 different vanishing points. So as far as we know, this is an image that realizes, as a word, that is technically correct from more vanishing points than any other image that we know of. It was technically rendered from, as it were, from 17 different vanishing points. And I do think it's extraordinary to reflect in the age of computer virtual reality, this image was done more than 500 years ago. And so in the 16th century, there was a huge enchantment with the idea of what was called ideal cities. People had these utopian ideas about how could we create a kind of paradise on earth. And representations of this concept were always, as it were, geometrically precise, perfect Euclidean visions of these gorgeous, rectilinear, perfectly perspectivally realized civic spaces. This was the ideal that Renaissance, 16th century Renaissance people envision for what would be the perfect city of the future. And you know, one of the things that I love about this is how much it is a bit like VR spaces today, except with it, VR spaces today are usually populated by warfare, but rather than civic harmony. But nevertheless, you get the idea. And so this is a 16th century conception of an ideal space, an ideal city. And these are two images of contemporary cities. So the top one is the Collegio Romano in Rome, but obviously it's a Renaissance building, but that's a photograph from today. And below is a rendering of Chicago. So it's interesting, isn't it, how much the perspective vision of the world has kind of, as it were, played out in reality. But this thinking about the world in this geometric way precipitated a crisis in Western thinking. It brought into being, you know, some absolutely gorgeous things, but it precipitated a crisis in thinking. And this is the crisis represented again in, this is another image by Raphael, also from the Sistine Chapel. Sorry, not Sistine Chapel, the Raphael room behind the Sistine Chapel. And so this is an image of what is, what's going on in this image, is that Raphael is trying to depict the relationship between heaven and earth, the same kind of idea that Giotto was depicting in the image we saw a few minutes ago. But Raphael now faces a technical problem. So what we have in the bottom part of this image is a scene with an altar. And on the bottom of the image are martyrs and saints and great wise men who are all destined to go to heaven. And in the top half of the picture, what we have is a picture of heaven with Christ in the middle of it and the apostles arrayed around him. But there's something very odd about this image now, because we have this very, very kind of unnatural, clunky, artificial looking bank of clouds hovering above the earth on which Christ and the apostles are sitting. And above Christ, what we have is this kind of golden circle. And what that golden circle, if you can see this in reality, it's actually gold leaf painted on the top part of it. And that is meant to be depicting the imperium heaven of God, the realm of God, which is beyond the physical world, outside of physical space, where the laws of geometry cannot possibly be said to apply. And what Raphael is wrestling with this image is the following question. If, as we have come to believe by this point, the realm of the earth is a Euclidean domain with everything, as it were, connectable through the laws of geometry, then what happens as we go away from the earth? What happens, as it were, to the soul? How can we have a realm of the soul in an age of geometry? If everything on the earth is, as it were, unified through geometry, where does the geometric domain end at some point? If we're to take seriously the realm of the Christian soul, then the realm of geometry must end somewhere, because there has to be a realm for the soul to be, as it were, outside of physical space. And that's the question that Raphael is here wrestling with in the late 15th century, sorry, the mid-16th century. And this represents the transformation that's about to happen when we move into the age of Newtonian and Galilean science, when indeed, as Newton and Galileo proposed, actually the realm of geometry in theory, according to Newtonian science, goes on forever. And according to Newtonian science, the Earth is no longer at the centre of a small finite bubble, but is just one planet floating in a big Euclidean void in an infinite universe, and that the whole universe is a geometrically coherent Euclidean space. And the problem that raises is, if the space of the physical world, the physical cosmos, goes on forever, then where can we possibly have a realm for the soul? Now, Newtonian cosmology and physics for hundreds of years afterward took for granted that ipso facto the geometric space of the world was Euclidean, because geometers, mathematicians, physicists all believed that there was no other form of geometry other than Euclidean. Except they did, in fact, know about another form of geometry, which was spherical geometry, the geometry of the surface of the Earth. But they didn't see that as a threat to the notion that the universe itself was Euclidean. But in the early 19th century, mathematicians, in fact, discovered that there are three different geometric alternatives. There's not only flat Euclidean geometry and the geometry of the surface of a sphere, there is another kind of geometry called hyperbolic geometry, which is the geometric opposite to a sphere. So one way of thinking about this is a flat Euclidean space, flat Euclidean plane, has no curvature, it's like zero. A sphere wraps around on itself and it's positive curvature, and if it makes sense that there's a positive curvature space, it sort of intuitively makes sense that there's a negative curvature space, and it turns out that indeed mathematically there is. There's this thing called hyperbolic space or hyperbolic geometry, which is the geometric equivalent of the negative numbers. So just as we have zero, positive numbers, and negative numbers, it turns out so too we have zero curvature, positive curvature, and negative curvature spaces. And we can talk about that a bit more in the question time if you like. But for the moment, I just want to say that basically the discovery of this negative curvature space, this hyperbolic geometry, also ushered in, as it were, not a crisis, but it was a crisis in mathematics, because mathematicians suddenly understood that if it is possible for mathematically there to be three different geometries, which one of those geometries is realized in the architecture of the cosmos? Is it possible that the universe itself is not Euclidean, but in fact maybe spherical or hyperbolic? And it is in fact possible that it is. And one of the hints that we have that other things are possible is that although mathematicians didn't realize it for a long time, we now know that nature is full of hyperbolic structures, particularly in the sea. These are some hyperbolic sponges and corals and flowers. All of these things are geometric manifestation, or sorry, biological manifestations of the geometry of hyperbolic space. So if alternative geometric structures are possible in flowers and sea slugs and cactuses and these beautiful lilies, is it possible that the architecture of the universe is something other than Euclidean? That is one of the questions that we're trying to answer using things like the Hubble Space Telescope. It's one of the main reasons that physicists and astronomers are sending these space telescopes up there, is to try to understand the question, what is the architecture of space itself? It looks like, actually, that although we know now that on the short scale space, on the level of our solar system, space actually has ripples. It looks like on the biggest scale of space that actually it probably is Euclidean, but there is some evidence that we might actually just live in a hyperbolic universe. And so I'm hoping very much that that might turn out to be the case. We don't know yet. It could be hyperbolic, it could be some weird version of spherical, but it does seem that actually in the architecture of the universe might just on the big scale actually be what the Renaissance geometers dreamed, and that is that it is Euclidean. So before I pass over to question time, I just wanted to show you an incredible piece of animation that I don't think we can go back to the whatever you need to do for streaming. Okay, so that's the end of the talk, so we can have a bit of a discussion.
I'd like to know, Margaret, how you personally became interested in the Renaissance arts and these kind of origins of geometric figuring, and so how did you personally come to get so interested in that?
Well, it was very simple that I kept reading. Before this book, I'd written another book. So my first book was a cultural history of physics. It was called Pythagoras' Trousers, and it's a cultural history of physics. And I became one of the huge moments, obviously, in the history of physics, is when Western culture made the move from the medieval cosmos to the Newtonian. Well, first of all, you get the medieval cosmos, then suddenly you get Copernicus, and then very quickly we move on to Newton. And it's all presented as if this is just suddenly coming out of empirical evidence, which is clearly not the case. Clearly there were other, not that there wasn't empirical evidence, but there was clearly a great deal, there must have been something else going on. You know, the medieval cosmos, the small finite thing, remained a stable view of the world 1500 years. Why did Western culture suddenly get disenchanted by it? And how did the new conception of space come into being? And it seemed from reading histories of science that scientists just kind of pulled this out of the blue, and that just didn't make sense to me. It seemed to me there had to be a much deeper story, much more going on. And then I stumbled, so I basically thought there's got to be a deeper story about concept, the change of conception of space going on. And so, well, someone must have written that book. There's got to be books written about the cultural history of our concepts of space. And I couldn't find one. It's funny, I've got a huge collection of books about cultural history of conceptions of time. A lot of people have written about the history of time, history of thinking about time. But I couldn't find a book that was a cultural history of concepts of space. So I thought, that story has to be told. If I can't find a book, I better write it. And I just stumbled, while in the beginning to do the research on that, I stumbled across a book that just was very seminal in my thinking in this. It's a book by an art historian, Samuel Edgerton. It's called The Heritage of Giotto's Geometry. And his book was written in the 90s. But he puts forward a view that I thought was just brilliant. He said basically that he believes that perspective painting set up the conditions. He doesn't put it quite like this, but this is what it effectively means. That perspective painting set up the conditions for Western people to reconceive of space in a new way, and that that actually made the revolution in physics possible. So he basically said before you could get Galileo, you had to have had Giotto. And I thought this was a really, really brilliant thesis, and linked it for me. It was this essential piece of the puzzle of showing how Western science in its reconceiving space didn't just start from scratch. It was actually carried on the back of 300 years of art history. And in that sense, I think it's an amazing story. You know, a lot of people talk about science and art today, and the big question is, can art actually be of any value to science? Well, this is the case. We're actually... the art provided the foundation for science.
Mm. And there wasn't, at the time, there wasn't much of a distinction between an artist and a scientist.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, these are more modern terms.
Yeah. But what is really critical about this is that the Western scientific tradition of thinking about space actually rejected the Euclidean conception of space. So it's completely wrong to think that Euclid saw space, physical space, I mean, in a geometric way. Euclid was a mathematician, purely dealing with mathematics. And the idea that we have that there is a geometric, that we're sitting in a geometric spatial construct, was actually actively resisted for hundreds of years by Western scientific thinkers and philosophers. And I think that basically Samuel Edgerton is right, that actually what was the trigger for Western people actually becoming to accept that idea of space was not through philosophical argumentation, but through literally having the embodied experience of standing in front of these images like Giotto and go, oh look, I really do feel like I'm there in the presence of Christ and the angels. I really do feel that I'm there, that I'm being there with them. And that was what I wanted to talk about, was how it wasn't, I don't think, an intellectual, well, there was an intellectual revolution, but the intellectual revolution only came on the back of the experiential revolution of being there, of being made to feel that you are there. And that, as it were, experience, as it were, undermine all of the philosophical argumentation about why there couldn't be a physical, why there couldn't be a geometric conception of space. So in that sense, I think, as it were, VR has served an incredibly powerful role in our culture.
Did the classical Greeks ever experiment with perspective? I mean, is there any evidence of that? I haven't looked that up.
The Romans did.
Yeah.
I don't know about the Greeks, but the Romans, so late Roman imagery,
yeah,
had proto perspective in it, yes.
I mean, they calculated the circumference of the Earth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they must have
known about the projection.
Mm.
But a lot of the artwork's been lost. That's, I mean, we talked about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It
Well, they calculate the surface of the Earth, but you don't have to, in order to do that, you don't have to believe that the Earth is embedded in a big Euclidean void. I mean, to us it seems counterintuitive. We're so obsessed with the idea that space is a geometric domain, but prior to people like, well, prior to the Renaissance artists, that wasn't an idea that people thought at all. In fact, there was a lot of thinkers in the, you know, in Europe, all through the Middle Ages and all through the Renaissance period, the natural philosophers of the time actively didn't think that way. They actually rejected that way. I mean, to us it seems so natural and so intuitive that we've actually forgotten what a radical thing it was to begin to think that way at all. And it gets back to this problem of heaven and earth, because it completely annihilates how you can make sense of the idea of the heaven. It makes it very difficult to think of, to conceive of heaven as within the domain of the real, if you think that the real is totally described, or the totality of the real is describable through mathematical laws. One of the things that I argue at the end of my book is that basically I believe that Western culture has been in a crisis, basically a psycho-spiritual crisis, ever since the discovery of this mathematical conception of the world, because unlike the medievals who conceive of an end to the physical world and therefore somewhere else for the soul to be, we have no conception of where our spirit, soul, psyche, whatever word you want to use, might be, because our conception of reality is now confined to a geometrical construct where you have to be able to say, well, here's its coordinates. But if you can't say its coordinates in the mathematical construct, then it's hard to argue for where it might be, and if it can't be anywhere, then how can it be at all?
That's a question at the back.
Could we have some lights on? I can't see a thing.
Please go ahead. Margaret, have you looked at the Eastern philosophy and their conception of space? Contrast that with the sort of Western Christian viewpoint?
I haven't, and I would love it if such a book existed, and perhaps it does, but I would love it if someone would do, as it were, you know, a Chinese version of this, or a, you know, Arabic version, or... But I'll tell you a lovely story. So this notion of space that we take for granted, that space is this Euclidean void and we can locate everything at this, you know, that point and that point and that point. Years ago, I encountered an anthropologist who told me the following story. And he said, you know, this conception of space strikes a lot of non-European people as being completely mad. And he told me the following. He said that he works with these people in Namibia, and they have a wildly different conception of space. And they believe that each person has a self space, that, you know, that my self space is like a bubble around me. You know, it's kind of, I don't think there's a hard edge, but it's, I'm surrounded in a like bubble-like self space that's porous. And you also, each one of you have a self space around you. And as we're moving about in our daily lives, these Namibian people in their village, they feel their self spaces connecting with the self spaces of everybody else. So, you know, these bubbles are sort of porous and intersecting with one another. And so this guy explained to the anthropologist that in his culture, they never felt they were alone, because their selves were literally intersecting with other self spaces. And he said to this Western anthropologist, do you people really believe that you're isolated points alone in an empty void? And he said, yeah, that's what our science tells us to believe. And he said, this Namibian man looked at him with infinite pity and said, how do you bear it?
And my answer is I don't think we are buried. I think we're going mad. I think our conception of space is literally driving us mad.
I wondered if you might be able to speak to the reversal where from you talked about the move into virtual reality, and I was thinking of an architect like Bellini who took the perspective and then, as it were, made it physical, so you get that interplay between these visual representations and actual architectural practice in that case. So that you get tricks of perspective in his chapels and things like that, so they look a lot more, the corridors look a lot longer than they really are, and he plays with the physical space in that way to you know, mess with our minds, but in the actual reality as opposed to the virtual.
Right. I know that architects did that they were interested in playing visual tricks with viewers, and it's not a subject I'm hugely conversant with. I know that in the late Renaissance, there were that was something that was done in painting in very interesting ways, and which I find really fascinating. So in late perspectival, there was imagery. There were a number of painters, and Leonardo was one, and Mantegna was the most famous, who deliberately constructed imagery with odd perspectives, often with buildings in them, at odd angles. And they were very deliberately trying to make people feel something wildly different than the original intention. Perspective, and this is quite interesting, I think. That so originally perspective emerged out of a desire to make you feel as a viewer, I'm here in relation to that image. You know, here's me and there's Christ, and we're coherently together, and you know, we're in the one space. But there was an alternative history of perspective, or alternative trend in perspective, that it was realized fairly early on that you could mess with people's minds and move the point of perspective in such a way that, as it were, you couldn't physically be in that relation to the image that you were seeing. Like Mantegna has some things where there's the point of perspective, you couldn't stand in front of the painting, actually be in that correct relation. But what they realized was that if you did it all the perspective correctly, that you could trick the mind into, as it were, shifting your perspective so that you feel that you were at the point of projection, even though your body couldn't be there. So they actually did tricks where they would make you feel as if the perspective, the projection point, was hovering outside of your body, outside, you know, like above your head or over here. So rather than it being about embodiment, which it had originally been, it then, or at least for some of them, it became about playing tricks to get you literally out of yourself. And some people have argued that there was, a religious point to this, that they wanted you not just to feel that you were embodied, but to actually get out of your body and to realize that you, as it were, had a spirit self soul beyond your body. And I think that's a really incredible thing. And one of the questions I wonder about, can we do something like that with VR now? You know, so much VR seems to be about getting you to feel, you know, I'm racing along the thing with the car, or you know, running down an alley, finding terrorists. Can we do what people like Mantegna were doing, and as it were, get us out of our body? Have a sort of, as it were, spiritual experience. And I would love to hear from you guys, is there anyone doing that in VR today?
just find me get a bit sick when you're not, when you've got in VR, like we try and do stuff with, yeah, shifting perspective, but when you're, you know you're
that's true.
5.5 feet off the ground, but it looks like you're 100, you automatically just want to stop and rip the thing off your head.
I'm very sensitive to that latency thing in VR, so I understand the phenomenon. That's actually a really interesting point. So that's as it were a limitation of
a
having
bit.
VR with motion, because it's a quality of motion.
Yeah, I think once
it's actually interesting.
Yeah, I mean we still do have a problem with frame rates and stuff, and I think once all that, and even having the wires attached to your head, you're not really free.
But so do you guys think that you could do this visual trickery that people like Mantegna did with VR, or is it?
Yeah, there's a lot of artists who have explored that in the sort of first round of VR in the 90s. There were a lot of works that looked at that.
You mean people like Sade?
Yes, yeah, that's a good example.
Well, Shah was definitely, I had the great pleasure of knowing her and experiencing her world, and they were amazing. She was more going for a spiritual experience in terms, she didn't want it to be too representational.
No, certainly not very representational.
Yes.
Well, I was looking at the underlying foundations of representation.
Yes.
Maybe just another question that comes to mind. So you're talking about the sort of crisis about space, but I think I would argue that what virtual reality has done, the sort of the zeitgeist, the popular zeitgeist at the moment is what virtual reality reinforces, that reality is a construction. So you get you know, you get films like The Matrix, the idea that you can create space and time in a way that suits you seems to answer that question of, well, where does this other realm exist? Well, this realm is just, you know, you've got theories of parallel universes and all those kinds of things in some popular terms to point to the idea that reality is a construction. I think that, I think in the back of many people's minds, I mean, I don't know, but I imagine in the back of many people's minds that is a possible explanation. So they're not so concerned with the idea of Euclidean space, they're concerned with the idea that space and time are a construction, and technology has enabled reconstruction of that in a way that suits the same ways it always has throughout human history, through a person's interpretation, a cultural interpretation of their beliefs about the nature of the universe.
I completely agree with you, John, and I'm glad to hear you saying it, because you know, I come from the domain of physics, and physicists represent increasingly that they're on the verge of the theory of reality, where everything, and I'm not sure if you guys know, but these theories of everything are basically geometric constructs that will unify everything, matter, space, time, energy, everything, forces, into one geometric construct in which ultimately everything will be described as it were a byproduct of the geometry of space-time, which is the true reality. And beautiful though this idea is, I actually do think it's very problematic, and I think exactly what you said is fabulously right, because it seems to me that a generation of people brought up playing VR games and seeing these constructed realities and experiencing them will not believe in a unitary notion.
Well, at least the obvious question, if we can construct reality, that how do we know that the reality we're in is not constructed? I mean, there are answers to that question.
Well, I think that's a slightly different.
It is slightly different, but I mean, if you're talking about the cultural impact of virtual reality in terms of thinking about these kinds of issues, it seems to reinforce the idea that reality can be constructed, because you can make a world of your choosing, given enough time and resources, that is different than the world that you live in. So that immediately raises the possibility, well, if this is possible to do, then why can't the reality that we're in be one of those constructions, albeit a more sophisticated version of what we're capable of doing? Just like the paintings were a representation of some bigger idea, virtual reality is representational of a bigger idea that reality can be constructed.
I mean, there are a lot of philosophical problems with that stance. So we're talking about a popular opinion, not necessarily a strongly argued philosophical opinion.
Oh, I actually, in my next book, I'm going to argue exactly what you're saying. And and because I do actually think that this is what's happening, is that I think it's, I put it slightly differently than you're putting, but effectively I completely on the same agree, because I think what's happening is that people who are experiencing who've got the opportunity to experience multiple realities in a very experientially convincing way, it causes you to, as it were, I think, question consciously or unconsciously, that it's bringing forth a question of what is the epistemological status of the geometric description that the physicists have.
Mm.
Here's another geometrically constructed world. Here's another one. Well, what is the... It's not that... I don't think it's necessary to be seen as an argument for a multiverse, because I think that's actually very problematic in its own right. But I think it suggests that the geometric description of reality that physicists give us is just a descriptive model. It's not necessarily the reality.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's wonderful that in a sense history has come full cycle. So perspective painting helped to usher in the physics view of space. And now VR, which is the modern update on perspective, I think is actually giving us just as that gave us an experience of physical space that opened up that thing. Now we're having an experience of multiplicitous universes, which Ray, I do think, does actually cause into question the notion that there is one unitary reality. And the other thing that I think is interesting is as that stuff moves online too, I think people are having, whether it's through VR, but just through cyberspace as a general thing, whether it's visually realized or just the ability to zoom around, you know, the net, that people have very real sense and experience of being real beings that are not just their body. You know, when you're zooming around the net, doing stuff and talking, you know, having relations with people in different communities, you've got a very real sense, there's a me out there doing stuff that's not just in this chair. And I actually think that too is experientially challenging, as it were, the physical monism that came into being.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a big problem, and it is that Euclidean heritage that's been translated to the mobile platform that most people spend an increasing amount of time engaged with, which is, I mean, it's a completely different, it's a sort of Cartesian dualism thing about being in this non-space of the screen, which is a flat Euclidean space, and that being the primary source of your experience of the world, rather than you know, so all the sorts of really interesting, fascinating geometries and spaces that you talk about in your other work that you've explored come from the natural world, which is of course being diminished
yeah.
and is also experienced through a Euclidean space.
Yeah.
Seems to be quite, I mean, personally to me, seems a very limiting way of understanding the world. Even though, of course, the internet's given us access to so much information, it's done that by limiting the vehicle by which we experience the world.
Oh, well, I think that's true, that there's real problems of people spending massive amounts of time connected to their screens. But I think the interesting philosophical thing is that I do think that a generation or two of people who have so much of their experience, as it were, in some sense, out there in the net, whatever out there means, will not accept, as you said, John, this, as it were, physicalist, this totalizing physicalist epistemology. And I actually think, hooray! You know, maybe we are going to go back to some, I mean, I don't know what the new, you know, maybe we, I think in a sense we have come back to a kind of medieval experience that we are physical beings. Of course, we're all aware of being physical beings.
Mm.
But we are also these non-physical beings that are doing stuff in a domain that's not the physical realm. And I think that's a really, really interesting phenomenon that's happening. And I do wonder if this is going to be, as it were, the nail in the coffin of of physicalist monism, and the physicists making a final last stand against it, I think are going to be on the losing side of history.
Time will tell.
Time will tell, but...
Okay, if that's it, I'd like to thank Margaret for a wonderful presentation.